Welcome everyone. This is the last lecture in chapter 10, which is mainly dealing with the problem of noise and nonlinear distortion in microwave circuits. And in this lecture, we are going to combine all pieces together to obtain what is called the dynamic range of the microwave circuit or the microwave system. We have known from the previous lectures that we have a background noise level, and the response of the microwave circuit or the microwave system is nonlinear, and this nonlinearity will introduce gain compression. In addition, we have third order intermodulation, which is increasing rapidly compared to the linear performance, such that the third order intermodulation may reach the linear performance of the amplifier or of the microwave circuit at a point which we called it third order intercept point. And to avoid the effect of this intermodulation, it is required that the performance or the microwave circuit to be operating at a point where the third order modulation is much less than the linear signal, because the linear signal is the required signal if we are talking about amplifier. If you are talking about frequency multiplier, for example, or mixer, maybe the third order intermodulation will be the required signal. But for linear system, it is required to obtain the linear performance of the microwave circuit. So we have noise, we have gain compression, we have third order intermodulation. All these pieces together limits what is the minimum value of the output signal and the maximum value of the output signal, such that we have the required signal, not the noise, not the intermodulation. This minimum value of the output signal and output value of the output signal is defined as the dynamic range of the microwave circuit. If we are talking about an amplifier where the gain is greater than unity, we are talking about the output power and the output noise level and the maximum output bar. If you are talking about passive circuit or circuit with gain less than unity, we are talking about the input, the minimum input power and the maximum input power. For the case of an amplifier, for example, this may be the power range that is limited at the low end by the noise level and at the high end by the compression unit. So, for power amplifier, we are mainly talking about the linear signal. So, we are dealing with the 1 dB compression more than the third order intermodulation. In this case, this is essentially the linear operating range for the amplifier, and this is called the linear dynamic range. So, the linear dynamic range is mainly determined by the performance of the linear operation of the amplifier from the noise level to the 1 dB compression. On the other hand, for low noise amplifiers or mixers operating by limited noise, and we are talking about very small signal, so the maximum power level, it would be determined by the minimum signal where the third order intercept point or the third order intermediation point would be less than the noise level. In this case, we are sure that there is no third order intermodulation will be distorting the linear signal. So, we are limiting the case now to the maximum input power that makes the third order intermodulation at the same level of the noise level. In this case, the dynamic range, it would be from the noise level to the output power at the linear region in this case. This is defined as the spurious free dynamic range. Spurious free dynamic range, it means that this is the linear dynamic range which does not include at all any intermodulation noise, because the intermodulation noise in this case is below the noise level. So for low noise amplifier or mixers, operation may be limited by noise at the low end and the maximum power level for which the intermodulation distortion becomes unacceptable. This is effectively the operating range for which spurious response are minimum, or we are going to call it spurious free dynamic range. So we have two types of dynamic ranges. We have linear dynamic ranges, which may include third order intermodulation, and we have spurious free dynamic range, which does not include any higher order intermodulation. The question now, how to calculate such two dynamic ranges? And according to the requirement, we can say that, okay, I'm going to design this amplifier according to the linear dynamic range, but I'm going to design the other amplifier according to the spurious free dynamic range. For linear dynamic range, we are talking about the noise level as the minimum value of the output power, and the output 1 dB compression point as the maximum output power. So the linear dynamic range in dB is effectively the value of the output 1 dB compression point in dBm minus the noise level in dBm. Usually we don't reach to the noise level directly, because effectively if I'm talking about a communication system, I say that this communication system, the minimum signal should be greater than the noise level by a certain ratio, or in other words, the signal to noise ratio must be greater than specific value. So usually we are going to replace the noise level by the minimum signal level. So effectively the dynamic range is the 1 dB compression point minus the minimum signal level or minimum acceptable signal level. So note that it may be preferred to define the linear dynamic range in terms of the minimum detectable power level or minimum acceptable power level. This definition is more appropriate than the definition in terms of the noise level, because this definition is more appropriate for a receiver system rather than individual component, and it depends on factors external to the component itself, such as the type of modulation, the recorded signal to noise ratio, the effect of error correcting code, and other related factors. So generally speaking, we are talking about the linear dynamic range as the output 1 dB compression point minus the minimum acceptable signal for the system. This is the linear dynamic range. For the case of spurious free dynamic range, let me at the beginning remind you with the third order intermodulation, we said that for a general nonlinear device or nonlinear system, the output signal is related to the input signal as a Taylor series with different coefficients A0, A1, A2, A3, and so on. And the linear power is given by B of the linear operation, B omega 1, is half the linear coefficient A1 squared multiplied by V naught squared, where V naught is the amplitude of the input signal, assuming that we have sinusoidal signal. The third order intermodulation signal in this case, it was given by this relation, half 3 over 4 A cube V naught cube to the power 2, which can be simplified as 9 over 32 a cube squared v naught to the power 6. The discussion of this point is discussed in detail in a previous video. So please, if you don't remember it, refer to a previous video for the third order intermodulation. Now, the relation between or the third order intercept point is defined as the input signal, which means that the linear output equals the third order intermodulation signal. So, at the third order intercept point, assuming that the input voltage is V intercept point, so the linear power equals the third order intermodulation. So, half A squared V intercept point squared, which is the linear power, equal the third order intermodulation, which is 9 over 32 A3 to the power 2 V intercept point to the power 6. From this, we can find that the input voltage signal at the intercept point, from this relation, it can be obtained as the square root 4 is A over 3 A3, 4A1 over 3 A3. Simply, we are going to divide this by this, and here we have 32 over 2, it would be 16, 16 over 9. Now we have V intercept point to the power 6 over V intercept point to the power 2, so this V intercept point to the power 4. We are going to take the fourth root of the right hand side. The fourth root of the right hand side, it would be this square root 4a1 over 3a3 under square root. This is the input voltage at the intercept point. From the input voltage at the intercept point, we can find out the output third order intercept point. It is given by the power at this voltage. So it would be simply half A1 squared multiplied by V intercept point squared. From this, this would be 4 over 3, and we have already 2, so it would be 2 A to the power this A to the power 3, this would be A to the power 3 over 3 A3. Alright, this is the output intercept point. From this output intercept point, we can say that, okay, the third order intermodulation point, the third order intermodulation point, it can be defined in terms of the linear power, the third order intercept point can be obtained in terms of the linear power as the third order intermodulation, the third order intermodulation, it would be the linear power cube. The linear power cube is half cube A1 to the power 6, V naught to the power 6. Okay? But already we have 9 over 32 A to the power 3, A3 to the power 2, V naught to the power 6. From the definition of the output intercept point in terms of A1 to the power cube over 3 A3, we can prove that the value of the third order intermodulation equals the linear power. So we can say that, okay, here we we can see that, okay, we have here, this is half a 1 squared v naught squared, which is b1 b omega 1 to the power 3. This is 1 over 8 a1 to the power 6 v naught to the power 6. The remaining it would be 8 over a1 cube multiplied by 9 over 32 a3 2. So this should be multiplied by 8 over a1 cube multiplied by 9 over 32 a. Okay, so we can say that this is b1 b omega 1 cube multiplied by 8 over a1 cube 9 over 32 a3 to the power 2. On the other hand, we say that the intercept, the output intercept point is 2 a1 cube over 3 a3. So if we say that 1 over output intercept point is 3 cube, this would be this 2 to the power 2. So this is would be 9 a 3 to the power 2 over 2. Here it would be 8 a 1 to the power 6. So what we have here, here we have 9, we have 4 here, we have 4 here, we have a to the power 3. No, this originally was a to the power 6, because this a1, so this is a to the power 6, right? This is a to the power 6. So we are here. Here is 4. So we should have 4. Yes, this is 2. This is should be 4. Yes. This is 4. Exactly. So we are now here. So we have 9. A 3 to the power 2 over 4 a to the power 6. This means that the power of the intermodulation signal of the third order intermodulation signal equals the linear signal to the power 3 over the output intercept point of the third order output intercept point to the power 2. So this is correct. Alright, okay. So from this, we have now the output or the third order intermodulation equal. The third order intermodulation equal the linear output cube over the output third order intercept point to the power 2. This just reminder for the nonlinearity. Now we are going to use this in calculating the spurious free dynamic range In this various free dynamic range, we say that, okay, we are going to increase the input power, so the output power in the linear region is going according to the linear relation, and the third order intermodulation is going according to the third order law. Now, we are going to increase the input power as long as the third order intermodulation is below the noise level. This means that I cannot detect any third order intermodulation. So I have only the linear signal, because the third order intermodulation in this case is below the noise level. So actually I'm measuring the noise. So we are going to define the spurious free dynamic range as the output power of the linear region to the input or the output power of the third order intermodulation when the third order intermodulation signal, the third order intermodulation signal at the output is equal to the noise level. As we said here from the previous slide, the third order intermodulation is related to the linear output signal as the linear output signal cube over the third order output point square. So the third order intermodulation is the linear power cube to the output third order intercept point square. Now, from this relation, we can say, okay, we are going to replace the linear power B omega 1 to be out intercept point, output third order intercept point to the power 2 over 3 multiplied by the power of the second or the third order intermodulation to the power 1 over 3. From this, we are going to use it in calculating the spurious free dynamic range as we are going to replace B omega 1 or the linear portion by the output intercept point to the power 2 over 3 multiplied by the third order intermodulation power to the power 1 over 3. From this, we can say that, okay, the spurious free dynamic range would be the output intercept point or the third intercept point 3 over the third order intermodulation, all of them to the power 2 over 3. This come from here, and this 1 over 3 over 1, so it would be in the denominator 2 over 3. Now, we are going to limit the third order intermodulation signal to the noise level. So, the output dynamic or the spurious free dynamic range, it would be the output third order intercept point over the noise level to the power 2 over 3. This is the ratio. If we are talking in terms of dB, it would be 2 over 3, because in the log scale, the power, it would be just multiplication, 2 over 3, multiplied by the output intercept point or the third order intercept point in dBm, the output third order intercept point in dBm, minus the noise level in dBm. So the spurious free dynamic range would be defined as 2 over 3, the output third order intercept point in dBm minus the noise level in dBm. This is how to calculate it, but if you want to define it, it is effectively the range of the output linear power to the noise level when the third order intermodulation is just equal to the noise level. This is physically, but for calculating, can be calculated as 2 over 3 multiplied by the output third order intercept point minus the noise level. Alright? So, this is how to calculate the spurious free dynamic range for a system. It is quite clear that the spurious free dynamic range is much less than the linear dynamic range. So, if you are talking about power, for example, for power amplifier, we usually use linear dynamic range. But if you are concerned with the intermodulation and any intermodulating signal, and we don't need any intermodulation in the output, so we are talking about the spurious free dynamic range, which is less than the linear dynamic range. So spurious free dynamic range can be calculated as 2 over 3 multiplied by the output third order intercept point minus the noise level. In a receiver, it may be required to have a minimum detectable signal. Once again, instead of the noise level, we can say that what is the minimum signal or the minimum signal noise ratio in order to achieve a specific performance. This requires an increase in the input signal and resulting corresponding decrease in the spurious free dynamic range in this case. So, for a specific signal to noise ratio, for example, the spurious free dynamic range would be the original spurious free dynamic range according to the noise level minus the signal to noise ratio or the required signal to noise ratio. Alright? Because effectively, the signal to noise ratio is the signal power minus the noise power. So, effectively, in this case, we are talking about 2 over 3 out intercept point minus the noise figure or the noise signal minus the signal to noise ratio. As an example on dynamic range, we have a receiver with a noise figure 7 dB and 1 dB compression point of 25 dBm referred to the output. So this is output 1 dB compression point and it has a gain 40 dB and third order intercept point at 35 dBm. And if we remember, we have a relation between 1 dB compression point and third order intercept point. The third order intercept point is greater than the compression point, 1 dB compression point, by between 10 to 15 dB. Effectively, in this case, it is 10 dB. So, this is the parameters of the receiver. If the receiver is fed with an antenna having a noise temperature T antenna equals 150 Kelvin and the desired signal noise ratio is 10 dB. It is required to find out the linear and spurious free dynamic range. Assume that the receiver bandwidth is 100 MHz. In this case, we study what is the noise, what is the noise in the problem. So, the noise level of the complete system, it would be the gain of the system multiplied by KTB. T in the present case is the combination between the antenna noise temperature plus the noise temperature of the receiver. And effectively, we don't have the noise temperature of the receiver, but we have the noise figure. So the noise temperature of the receiver can be obtained from the noise figure as the noise figure minus 1 multiplied by the ambient temperature, which is 290 Kelvin. And as we mentioned, in the noise figure is determined at the ambient or the room temperature. So the total noise temperature of the system, in this case, it would be the antenna temperature or the antenna noise temperature plus the noise temperature at the receiver itself. Again, it was 40 dB. 40 dB in linear, it would be 10 to the power 4. The value of the Boltzmann constant is 1.38 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 23. The operating bandwidth is 100 MHz. 100 MHz is 10 to the power 8 Hz. Multiplied by the temperature of the antenna, the noise temperature of the antenna, 150 Kelvin, plus noise figure minus 1. The noise figure, 7 dB here, is converted to a ratio as 10 to the power 0.7. Then 10 to the power 0.7 minus 1, it would be 4.01, multiplied by the ambient temperature or the room temperature, which is 290 Kelvin. From this, we can obtain the equivalent noise temperature of the system consisting of the antenna and the receiver. And from this temperature, we can obtain the background noise level for such receiver. So the background noise level of such receiver is 1.8 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 8 watt, which it can be represented in dBm as we are going to divide it by 1 milliwatt, which is 1 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 3, and taking 10 log this value, so we can find the noise level as minus 47.4 dBm. This is the noise or the background noise. Now, the dynamic or the linear dynamic range, it would be the output 1 dB compression point minus the noise level. So the output 1 dB compression point, it was 25 dBm. So it would be 25 dBm minus the noise level. So minus minus 47, it would be plus 47.4 dBm. So the linear dynamic range in this case is 72.4 dB. Now, for the case of the spurious free dynamic range, the spurious free dynamic range, it would be calculated as 2 over 3, the output third order intercept point, minus the noise figure. And in this case, it is required to obtain a signal-to-noise ratio 10 dB. So we would be minus this signal-to-noise ratio. So it would be 2 over 3 output intercept point, output third intercept point. The output third order intercept point, it was 35 dBm. So this would be 35 dBm minus minus 47.4. So it would be 2 over 3, 35 plus 47.4 minus the signal to noise ratio. From this, we can obtain the spurious free dynamic range is 44.9 dB. It is quite clear that the spurious free dynamic range is much less than the linear dynamic range. Even if I didn't include the signal to noise ratio, it would be 54.9, which is still less than the linear dynamic range. So now it is less than the linear dynamic range because of two reasons. The spurious free dynamic range is less than the linear dynamic range by itself. In addition, we have included the signal-to-noise ratio in this case for the spurious free, so it has been decreased also by an additional 10 dB. By this end, we have completed chapter 10, which is dealing with the problem of the noise and nonlinear distortion in microwave circuits and microwave systems. In the following chapter, we are going to discuss the basic elements for microwave active devices like the diodes and the transistors. Then, in the following chapter, we are going to discuss how to design an active circuit for microwave circuits. So, see you in the next chapter, which is microwave devices. And we are going to start, as I said, with microwave diodes.